Good morning all. Today we are going to discuss the basic working principle of rotating machines. So they are based on the principle of Faraday's laws of electromagnetic inductions. So this Faraday's laws of electromagnetic induction states that the EMF induced will be proportional to rate of change of flux linkages. In order to get that, there are some basic requirements. The basic requirements are, first there should be a magnetic field, and second there should be a set of conductors. And there should be a relative space variation or time variation between set of conductors and magnetic field. That means the basic requirements are, there should be a magnetic field and there should be a conductor, and either the magnetic field will be varying with respect to time and the conductor is stationary, or the second option can be either the magnetic field is stationary and the conductor is moving inside the magnetic field. So based on that, there are two possible methods. So let us see those methods one by one. So the first method is method one. The magnetic field is time varying and conductors are stationary. So this leads to statically induced EMF. The name is telling statically induced EMF or static. Always we tell the EMF with respect to the conductor, because in this case the conductors are stationary and the magnetic field is time varying, so that the flux linkages, rate of change of flux linkages comes, because of that the EMF will be induced. So this principle is used in transformers. So this we have already discussed in the transformers. So the second method is useful for the rotating machines, method number two. So in the case of second method, the magnetic field is stationary and the conductors are moved. So this is called as the conductors are moving, or we can tell the conductors are dynamic. So this is called as a dynamically induced EMF. So this principle is used in DC machines, which we are going to see in details now. So now, as our concern is only about the rotating machines, so that's why I am going with only the second principle. So the second principle is dynamically induced EMF. The magnitude of dynamically induced EMF is given by flux cutting law. Because the flux is cutting with the conductor, so it is given by the flux cutting law, and the magnitude is mainly given by the flux cutting law, and the basic principle is Faraday's law of electromagnetic induction. So to analyze this or to understand this, let us assume this is my magnetic field. So let us assume my magnetic field is B Tesla. So B Tesla magnetic field or magnetic flux density is there. So inside there is a conductor. So let us assume conductor is a straight conductor, and let us assume out of this conductor the effective length that is falling inside the magnetic field is LE, which stands for effective length of the conductor. So from this we can analyze, this is my direction of the magnetic field. And let us assume this conductor is moving at a linear velocity of v meters per second in this direction. And let us assume there is an angle of theta. It is moving at some angle with respect to B, flux density. So where this theta, theta is the angle between B and the velocity or linear velocity. So this states that the dynamical induced EMF is proportional to the velocity and the flux density, the cross product of these two, because velocity also vector and flux density is also having a vector because it is in a particular direction. Or we can tell that the dynamically induced EMF is given by B into effective length into velocity into sine of the angle between B and E. This is the formula for dynamically induced EMF, where we have to remember here where LE is effective length of conductor. Falling in the magnetic field. So let us assume if conductor is not straight, the conductor is having some curved nature. So in that case, what will be there? So let us assume again, this is my flux. So in this, let us assume this conductor is having some curved nature. So let us assume this is my effective length. So let us assume this is my direction of B, and let us assume it is moving at a velocity of V meters per second. Remember here, this V is the linear velocity in meters per second. The angle between them is theta. So to analyze this, so what we have to do, we have to take a small, because it is not a straight line, we cannot take the total length. So I am taking the small length, differential length dl. So from this, I can calculate the differential EMF induced is equal to B into V into sine theta, that means V referred in the direction of B, into differential length. And if you want to calculate the total EMF, I can calculate using the line integral. So I can calculate the line integral of B into V into sine theta into dl. Or if you calculate this, this you will get as the line integral of V cross B. Remember this bar indicates the vector into dl. Using this, we can find it. So this direction of the dynamically induced EMF can be found by using Fleming's right hand rule. This is used for finding direction of EMF. So how to find this? So in this, if your thumb is indicating the direction of movement or the velocity, and your forefinger or the pointing finger indicates the direction of the magnetic field, then this middle finger indicates the direction of the EMF induced, the direction of EMF induced, or the current, the direction of the current produced because of the EMF induced. So let us try to analyze this by taking some conductors. So let us assume I am taking a north pole, a south pole, in that I have taken a core. In this, two conductors are there. One conductor is here, another conductor is there, and this conductor I am representing with A, this conductor I am representing with B. Let us assume it is rotating in the clockwise direction. It is rotating in the clockwise direction. So I am representing the magnetic field and other things. This is the direction of the magnetic field, which is moving inside the magnetic field. So if you take the conductor A, so conductor A, because it is rotating like this, so at any point if you want to find the direction of the motion, linear velocity direction, you have to take the tangent at that point. So we can tell that the direction of the velocity is, this is my direction of the velocity and this is my direction of magnetic field. So what will be the direction of the current? The direction of the current I can found by applying my Fleming's right hand rule. So Fleming's right hand rule, if you apply, you just keep it in such a direction, your forefinger indicates the direction of the magnetic field. That means you have to turn this in the counterclockwise direction. So then your velocity is towards the right side. Then you can find that the direction of the current will be towards inside or the direction of EMF induced will be cross here, will be cross here. And if you come to the second conductor, so second conductor we can apply this, just you have to turn it in the right hand side. So this is the direction of the magnetic field, and because this conductor is moving in clockwise direction, so this is my direction of V. So if you apply, then you will get that the direction of EMF induced will be towards S. Towards S means same thing like this window, it is pointing outwards, or we can represent with dot. So in this conductor dot is induced, and this conductor cross is induced. So this is given by the Fleming's right hand rule. Let us now see what will be the behavior of the EMF in a conductor when this is moving in a magnetic field. So let us take it under different conditions so that it will be clear to us. So I have taken a north pole, I have taken a south pole. Let us assume this pole is extending like this. So inside this I am just keeping one conductor. There is one conductor. So let us take this as conductor A, B, C, D. Okay, which is this taken to the output. So now let us assume this conductor is moving in clockwise direction as usual like before. So at each point, how it is going to induce the EMF, that we are going to see. So to analyze that easily, so I am representing this in two dimensional only. So I am just drawing it here. So this is my north pole, this is my south pole, this is my conductor A, and this is D. Okay, and this one is rotating in clockwise direction. So you can apply it at this point. So this is my magnetic field. This is one conductor, this is another conductor. Because at this point, because that motion of linear motion of the conductor, I can represent as the tangential in the direction of motion, and for this it is moving like this. You can see when the conductor is moving, the number of lines of flux it is cutting per second, because it is moving vertically. Like you are want to cross a road, you are moving there, like there is a road, a person want to cross the road. So if you move straight, it can cover the entire road in minimum possible time. But if he is moving at some angle, it will take more time to cross the road. Or the total effective distance he is traveling across the road will be less if he is moving at a cross. But if he is moving perpendicular, the effective distance he has crossed will be minimum where he want to reach. Effective distance will be maximum, so he is moving. So same way, in this case, when the conductor is at this point or at this point, you can see it is moving perpendicular to the magnetic field. So that's why it cuts more flux of lines, or the flux linkages, the rate of change of flux linkages will be maximum. As the rate of change of flux linkages are maximum, the EMF induced will be maximum under this case. Let us take the another case. Let us assume after some time this conductor comes here. So conductor A comes here, conductor B comes here. So at this point you can see the conductor is moving like this. This conductor B is moving like this. You can see it is moving horizontal to the field. So when it is moving horizontal to the flux, the rate of change of flux linkages or the number of flux lines it is cutting per second is zero. So we can tell that at this point the rate of change of flux linkages are zero, or we can tell that it is violating my Fleming's right hand rule. So EMF will not be induced in this case. If the conductor is at some point here in between, so this conductor will be like this. That means this is my direction of B and this is my direction of V. So you can see there is an angle of theta. So we have told that we have to take the angle sine theta as for the flux cutting law. So sine theta, because we know when theta is equal to 90 degrees, the sine theta is equal to 1. When theta is equal to 0, sine theta will be equal to 0, and it is in between, the value will lie in between. That means we can tell that at this point, let us assume this point I am naming 1, 2, 3, 4. When the conductor is at point 1, the angle theta is equal to 90 degrees. So automatically the EMF induced will be maximum, because sine 90 is equal to 1. When the conductor is at point 2, that means at this point, so at this point 2, So it is making some angle theta. Theta is between 0 less than theta less than 90 degrees. So EMF induced is medium because it is non-zero. But when you are taking at this instant, that means when it is at a perpendicular, so this theta angle between the B and V is 0 degrees. When the angle between B and V is 0 degrees, that means the dynamically induced EMF will become equal to 0. That means there are two ways how to analyze this. Either you can see the rate of change of flux linkages or how many flux lines are cutting per second at different locations. Using that we can analyze. Other option is directly going with the flux cutting law. So flux cutting law tells that the EMF induced is equal to B into V into sin theta, sin of the angle between B and V. So depending on what is the angle between B and V, using that also we can find what is the magnitude of the EMF. So let us see the magnitude of the EMF under different states so that we can analyze it. So I'm taking, this is my north pole, this is my south pole. Okay. I'm taking the rotor. Let us see different positions. So I'm taking a single conductor only. Let us take the conductor. This is position 1, 2, 3 and 4. So let us assume it is moving in clockwise direction. Let us see how it is going to cut. So now I am again drawing the flux lines. So at point number 1, this is the direction of the flux and it is moving in clockwise direction. So it is moving in the clockwise direction. This is my direction of velocity. Here this is my direction of velocity. Here this is my direction of velocity. And here this is my direction of velocity. And direction of B, this is my direction of B at every point. This is my direction of B. And if similarly here this is my direction of B. And similarly here also this is my direction of B. So now we are trying to analyze. So at point 1, you can see the direction of V and B are 180 degrees opposite to each other. So we can tell that the EMF induced, the dynamically induced EMF is B into LE into V into sin theta. This theta is equal to 180 degrees. If you substitute 180 degrees, so at this point the EMF induced will be 0. So EMF induced is 0. This is with respect to at different locations, omega t, or we can tell with respect to angle theta. So let us take this as reference, or this is at 0 degree location. This is my, I am taking as 0. So now at point number 2, at point number 2, the angle between V and B is 90 degrees. So the direction of EMF we can find by using Fleming's right hand rule. If you find using the Fleming's right hand rule, you will observe that the direction of EMF will be towards inside, or it will be a cross here. So let us assume that cross I am representing by plus. So it will be maximum at this point. So if you take in between, I have discussed it before, the angle will be between 0 and 90 degrees. So it will be intermediate or medium. So now I have reached point number 2. So now let us see the case at point number 3, 4 and again coming to point number 1. Now at point number 3, you can see the angle between V and B is again 0 degrees. So automatically the EMF induced will be 0. The EMF induced becomes 0. Now coming to point number 4. At point number 4, the direction of B and V is again 90 degrees. So EMF induced will be maximum. The direction of EMF induced, if you find it, you will get it as a dot. As we have taken the cross as positive, automatically dot will be negative. So it will be negative maximum. So similarly, when you are moving till 1, it will go on decreasing because this angle decreases from 90 degrees to 0 degrees. Or we can tell that the angle above 90 degrees is increasing, then the magnitude decreases, sign of the value decreases. So automatically this will be the value. So this is my direction of value of the dynamically induced EMF. So we can tell that if a conductor is moving inside a magnetic field, it follows the sinusoidal waveform. That means the sinusoidal waveform is induced in the conductor loss. I hope it is clear up to now. If you have any queries, you can leave your comments in the comment section below. So I will reply to your comments from there. Thank you. Thank you very much.